तेजस्विनावधीतमस्तु मा विद्विषावहै। ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः।
Discussed in the last lecture the superposition theorem and the substitution theorem, and we also mentioned that we had already discussed the reciprocity theorem while we were dealing with the two port networks. We will now move ahead and have a review of the Thevenin's theorem using the framework of the Laplace transform domain. Thevenin's theorem is also known as Helmholtz theorem in the German literature, because there is some dispute about as who originally proposed this theorem. In the English literature, of course, it is commonly known as Thevenin's theorem. In German literature, you often find this referred to as the Helmholtz theorem. The statement of the theorem runs on analogous lines to what you are familiar with in the context of DC circuits or AC circuits. But in the case of Laplace transform domain, in the context of the Laplace transform domain, we can put it in this fashion. A two-terminal network NA containing linear elements and independent sources, is equivalent to a simpler network containing an independent voltage source in series with a two-terminal network having an impedance function Z0 of S. So a whole complex network containing several sources and a number of linear elements connected in a complicated arbitrary fashion can be reduced to a very simple series circuit containing one independent source and a two-terminal network or a one-port network in series with the source, which has a driving point impedance Z0 of S. Now, how do you calculate the source? The source voltage is the open circuit voltage of NA. So, in time domain, it is the open circuit voltage in time domain, or you can use it in Laplace transform domain. It is the Laplace transform of whatever is the open circuit voltage of NA. That is, when the two terminals of NA are kept open, whatever voltage you get, its Laplace transform will be the source voltage transform. The impedance Z0 of S, which is to be connected in series with the source, is the effective impedance, also called the output impedance, of NA measured at its terminals after deactivating all independent sources in NA. When we say deactivate all independent sources, we mean that the voltage sources must be replaced by short circuits, the current sources must be replaced by open circuits. Now, this statement of the theorem is, I'm sure, familiar to all of you, except that we are now putting it in terms of transformed quantities. Now, how do we justify this theorem? Let us look at these charts. This is our NA, which contains linear elements acted upon by several sources. So diagrammatically, we can represent that we have a network N, which contains purely linear elements, and we have several voltage sources and current sources acting in the network. So we put all the linear elements inside this box and call that N, and represent the various current sources and voltage sources connected to this N externally. So this is a typical voltage source. I put VSK of S. That means this is a kth source. There may be several such sources. Similarly, there is a current source, one current source is represented. There may be several current sources which are also acting at the same time. This is, the whole thing constitutes a two-terminal network NA with the terminals P and Q. So, we would like to establish an equivalent for this entire network. What do we mean by equivalent? That is, if this network has a terminal voltage VL of S and a terminal current IL of S when it is connected to an external network NL, then if the equivalent is connected to NL, we should get the same quantities VL of S and IL of S. When we talk about an equivalent network, it goes without saying that the external conditions must remain invariant. We do not worry about what happens inside this network. As far as the terminals are concerned, we get the same effect when it is connected to any other arbitrary network. So I would like to indicate this as NA, meaning that it's an active network containing independent sources. N is the linear part of it. And what is connected externally is the what we may refer to as load network. It could be any network as long as it has two terminals. So I refer to this as load network for simplicity, and I represent this as NL. So when this two-port network, when this one-port network is connected to NL, let us say there is a voltage VL and a current IL in the transform domain. Now, by substitution theorem, there is a current IL passing through this. So if I connect IL of S, a current source of exactly the same magnitude as this, same value as this, same function as this, then there should not be any disturbance created in the network. So all elements will continue to have the same variables associated with them. So if I connect a current source here, replace this NL by current source, I should still get VL of S here, and all elements inside must have the same variables associated with them. When we talked about substitution theorem, we said an element can be replaced by a current source or a voltage source. It need not be one element. We can have a whole one-port network can be replaced by IL of S as long as the current in the one port is IL of S. So this particular equivalent is obtained by using substitution theorem, replacing NL by IL of S. Now, I would like to calculate this VL of S in this network by superposing the effects of, because after all, N is linear and we have several sources acting on them. So N is linear network, and this linear network is acted upon by several voltage sources, several current sources, ISK of S, plus another source, current source, IL of S. So in order to calculate VL of S, I take up the approach of superposition. I consider all these voltage sources and current sources one time, find out its contribution to VL of S. Then I deactivate these sources and consider only this source and find out its effect. I superpose those two effects, I should get whatever VL of S would be. So to do that, I am saying this: the conditions in this network can be obtained by superposing the effects in these two networks. In the first network, I still keep this linear network, but it is acted upon by the original voltage sources that are present in NA and the current sources that are present in NA, but this IL of S is deactivated, so that is kept open circuited. So the two terminals are kept open circuited, and let, as a result of this, we have a voltage VOC of S developed across PQ. This is called the open circuit voltage. So in this original network NA, if you open circuit the terminals, whatever voltage you get, its Laplace transform is referred to as VOC of S. This is the open circuit voltage. In time domain, it may be VOC of T, but in transform domain, it is VOC of S. Along with this, if you take the current source acting alone and you deactivate all the sources, independent sources in NA, these voltage sources are replaced by short circuits because the VSK of S is made equal to 0. Its voltage is made equal to 0, that means it's equivalent to short circuit. This current source strength is reduced to 0, therefore it is an open circuit. So if all the independent sources inside are deactivated, you get a configuration like this, where this linear portion of the network N is acted upon by only one current source, IL of S, all the other sources deactivate. So this is essentially, therefore, a one-port network, linear one-port network. A current source, IL of S, is driving that current, driving that one-port network. And so if the looking in impedance of this is Z0 of S, that is the driving point impedance of this one port after deactivating all the sources is Z0 of S. Then naturally the voltage that is developed between the terminals PQ is IL of S times Z0 of S, with Q being positive with reference to P as a reference direction. Therefore, the voltage that is developed across the terminals PQ is minus Z0 of S times IL of S if you take P positive as and Z0 of S times IL of S if you take Q as positive. Anyway, the overall VL of S, therefore, after all, the sum of these two must be equal to this voltage, which is equal to this voltage, of course. So as a result of this, we get VL of S equals, superposing these two effects, VOC of S, that is the voltage here, and the voltage between P and Q here is minus Z0 of S times IL of S. So we observe that in this network, we have the voltage across the load network VL of S is VOC of S minus Z0 of S times IL of S, where IL of S is the current flowing in this, and VOC of S is the open circuit voltage. So this particular equation is satisfied no matter what load you have by a simpler circuit like this. If I have a voltage source VOC of S, in series with a one port whose impedance function is Z0 of S, and I say these are the terminals PQ, and whatever I connect here, if this is the current is IL of S and the voltage is VL of S, so VL of S equals VOC of S minus Z0 of S times IL of S. That is exactly what this equation states. Therefore, for any given IL of S, VL of S will be given by this equation. This will also be given by this equivalent circuit, and that is what constitutes the conditions in the original network. After all, for a given IL of S, VL of S is dependent on the conditions inside, and what that conditions are, VOC of S minus Z0 of S times IL of S. In this discussion, we have not taken note of any special properties of NL of S. All we are saying is, whatever network which we connected, if IL of S is flowing, a certain voltage is developed, and therefore for a given IL, VL can be obtained from the properties of NA itself without paying any regard to the nature of NL, and therefore this is an equivalent circuit. So this is what constitutes the Thevenin's theorem statement in the Laplace transform domain. All we are talking about functions of S, the OS voltages and the impedance function. Our discussion so far has told us that a network like this with N containing linear elements plus acted upon by several sources can be replaced by an equivalent circuit of this type, where there is one source which is has a voltage which is equal to the voltage across the open terminals of PQ when NL is disconnected, that is called the open circuit voltage, and in series with an impedance which is the impedance measured at these two terminals after deactivating all the sources, which is called the output impedance, also called Thevenin impedance. So this is an equivalent circuit, and this is often referred to as the Thevenin equivalent of NA. So if you connect a particular one port network NL here and here, you get identical external conditions. When we say the two networks are equivalent, the external conditions are identical. We are not worried about what is happening inside NA and N Thevenin. Now a few comments on this are in order. One, N contains linear elements. This is important because we used superposition principle and so on and so forth. And these linear elements can be passive elements like RLC, M. They can also have dependent sources, linear dependent sources. Linear dependent sources like voltage control, voltage source, current control, voltage source, and so on. So N can contain any one of these passive elements, like the elements can be reciprocal or non-reciprocal. For example, passive elements like this are reciprocal elements or bilateral elements. Dependent sources are not reciprocal elements. So as far as n is concerned, all we demand on them is that you should contain linear elements. The elements can be reciprocal or non-reciprocal. We don't really bother about this. Two, when deactivating the sources, we continue with our concept that the voltage sources must be replaced by short circuits and current sources must be replaced by open circuits. So it is the same in the but we should do this only for independent sources. The dependent sources should be left intact, just as we used in the case of superposition, application of the superpositional principle. Only for independent sources. So when you are calculating the Thevenin impedance or the output impedance, we should deactivate only for independent sources. The dependent sources, if any, should be left intact. Three, NL, we have not said anything about NL. NL could be any network, can be linear or nonlinear. NL can be linear or nonlinear. There is no restrictions as on LL. All we demand is that it should have two terminals only. A fourth condition is that there should not be any coupling between NL and this. There should not be any coupling between an element here and an element here. There should not be a coupling. How does a coupling between two elements arise? For example, mutual inductances. They can also arise from control sources. A current here may control a voltage here. A voltage here may control a current here. I said, due to mutual inductances, control sources, there should not be such a coupling between elements of NA with those of NL. So all we demand is that the coupling between NA and LL must come only through these two interconnections, through terminals P and Q. We can't have a mutual inductance primary here and secondary here. We can't have a control source whose controlling quantity is here and control quantity is here, or vice versa. So provided these conditions are met, then this Thevenin theorem will work quite nicely. All we have to do is you replace the entire network by an equivalent series connection of a voltage source and a current source, and we can find out the currents in an external network. So if suppose you want to connect 10 different networks here, and you want to find out the currents, if you take the original network, it becomes difficult because you have to do the analysis 10 times. So if you are going to have repeated analysis of this network at these two terminals with different types of loads, it would be quite useful, of course, to replace this entire thing by a simple equivalent circuit here and then carry out this analysis with this simpler circuit for the 10 different loads. So naturally, the process becomes simpler. The overhead that you pay for establishing the Thevenin's theorem will pay for itself because you are going to do repeated additions, repeated calculations. And why we demand that there is no coupling between these two, an element here and this element here, is but once we replace this entire NA by its equivalent Thevenin network, then the identity of some of those elements inside are lost. Therefore, the original coupling terms between the coupling effects between a term here and an element here will no longer be available here. Therefore, this condition is vital, is also important. So with this, let me work out an example. Let us now consider this example as an illustration of the application of the Thevenin's theorem. We have in the circuit two resistances, one capacitor and one inductor, all of unit value, with a 1 volt source. The switch is kept open for a long time till steady state is established, and it is then closed at t equals 0. We are interested in finding out the current IT. So to solve this problem, there are several approaches. Of course, we can set up this transform domain equivalent circuit and then try to find out the current by the loop method or the node voltage method. We can also use the Thevenin's theorem, treating this entire network here, this portion as NA with two terminals, or maybe up to this two terminals, and then find out the effect of this load resistance of 1 ohm on the two terminal equivalent. So let us establish the two terminal equivalent of this network, taking these two as the terminals. So to do that, we want to work out in transform domain. Therefore, let us write the transform circuit of this configuration. So we have, first of all, the initial conditions. Before the switch was closed, the steady state was reached. That means the 1 volt charges, the source charges the capacitor to 1 volt. And once this is 1 volt, there is no current here. And current in this is also 0 because these two are the two nodes of the same potential. Therefore, there is no potential difference between these two. The current here is 0 and the current here is also 0. So the inductor carries no current. The capacitor carries a voltage of 1 volt. The charge, the capacitor is charged to a voltage of 1 volt. Therefore, the equivalent circuit of this will be 1 by S, that is the source voltage, 1 ohm. The capacitor has an impedance function S. We will put simply 1. This is the generalized impedance of the 1 ohm resistance. The capacitor has an impedance 1 over S, and the replacement of the initial condition across the capacitor is a source of equal to 1 by S because it has charged up to 1 volt. And now in this, we are closing the switch at t equals 0 to connect this to 1 volt. That means we want to find out the open circuit voltage. Therefore, if you call this terminal PQ, whatever we measure here is VOC of S. To find out the Thevenin impedance, what you do is you deactivate all sources, including those sources which come about to replace the non-zero initial conditions. These are the two terminals PQ after deactivating all independent sources. And whatever you measure here is that not plus. 1, 1, S, 1 over S. Now let us find the Z naught FS to start with. Now after all, this impedance S is connecting P and Q. Therefore, we may as well put this here. That means, in other words, this is, you have this S is coming here, and you have the capacitance, 1 over S, 1, and this 1 ohm now is in parallel with 1 by S. So that is what we are having. So to calculate Z naught of S here is quite straightforward. So I can write the Z naught of S equals 1 over, because this element is in parallel with something else. Therefore, the impedance of this will be 1 over. The impedance, this Z naught of S is the impedance. So I would like to calculate its admittance of the one port network. So I must invert this. The admittance of this is 1 by S plus admittance of whatever follows. The admittance of this portion of the network is what I should add there. But one element is in series, so I would like to consider its impedance. So the impedance of this combination is 1 plus the impedance of this. The impedance of this I can consider on the admittance basis. So once I have it on the admittance basis, The admittance of this is S, the admittance of this is 1. So I can interpret Z naught of S by means of an expression like this, which is the continued fraction expansion, as it is called. You can simplify this, and it turns out that this is equal to S times S plus 2 over S squared plus 2S plus 2. That is what Z naught of S would be. Now, if to find out VOC of S, you can use the Knott method of analysis or whatever it is, but it will be very soon evident to you after your calculation that this will indeed be, because just like you had 1 volt here and 1 volt here and no currents flow in this, similarly, this there will be no currents here, and therefore, this will also be equal to VOC of S will also turn out to be 1 by S. You can analyze this and show. But a much simpler way of analyzing this would be like this. Imagine what is happening under open circuit conditions in this. Suppose the switch was closed, but still you are open, after all, you are open, finding the open circuit voltage here. The switch is closed, no doubt, doesn't matter, let it be closed. But you are opening this out. Therefore, what is the open circuit voltage in this circuit? The open circuit voltage is exactly 1 volt DC, because there's no currents flowing through this. When the switch was open, what we are measuring is the open circuit voltage. Therefore, the open circuit voltage in this network is 1 volt DC, pure 1 volt DC, because there can't be any current here when the switch is open. The capacitor is already charged to 1 volt. There can't be current here. There cannot be current here. Therefore, this 1 volt will appear here at the terminals. Therefore, the open circuit voltage is 1 volt DC. Consequently, VOC of S is also 1 over S. In other words, when you want to find out the open circuit voltage, you don't always have to go to the transform domain. You can find out the open circuit voltage in time domain and take its Laplace transform. That will be the open circuit voltage. So the upshot of all this analysis, therefore, is that the Thevenin equivalent has 1 over S as the open circuit voltage, and a one-port network whose driving point impedance is S times S plus 2 over S squared plus 2S plus 2. This is equal to Z O of S. This is the Thevenin equivalent of our original configuration. Now you are connecting a 1 ohm resistance here, and you are asked to find out this current. So if you analyze this, I of S will turn out to be 1 by S divided by 1 plus S squared plus 2S divided by S squared plus 2S plus 2. That will be S squared plus 2S plus 2 divided by S times 2S squared plus 4S plus 2. And you make the partial fraction expansion of this, S squared plus 2S plus 2 times S squared plus 4S plus 2. You can make the partial fraction expansion of this, and you can show that this is equal to 1 by S minus half 1 over S plus 1 plus 1 over S plus 1 whole square, which means that the current IT equals 1 by S, that is 1, minus half e to the power of minus t. Come this, you get t times e to the power of minus t, the whole thing, of course, e of t. That is the current, 1 minus half e to the power of minus t, minus half t e to the power of minus t ut. That is the solution for this. Now, I would also like to demonstrate the use of substitution theorem to get the same solution. Now, let us look at this. I would like to see what happens when the switch is closed. This is what we are having. When the switch is closed, you want to find out the current here, I of S. Now, let me introduce here two voltage sources, okay, let me say when the switch is open, suppose when the switch is open, the voltage across this, which is VOCT. After all, that is the open circuit voltage, and let its Laplace transform be VOC of S. So if the replace the open switch by a voltage source VOC of S, which is exactly the Laplace transform of the voltage that is appearing across the open switch, then the conditions in the network are not altered. This is continues to be 0. I will be 0. So if you replace this open switch by a voltage source whose value at every instant of time is exactly the voltage that is appearing across the open switch, then the conditions in the network are not altered. That is the substitution theorem. So this is what we have. Now what I can do is, this entire thing, whatever we are having here, that will be replaced like this. Suppose I have two sources like this, which are equal and opposite, say source A, source B. Together, they add up to 0. That means the closure of the switch, when you close the switch, it's equivalent to having 0 voltage across the switch terminals, which is equivalent to connecting two voltage sources of equal and opposite values in series. So the closed switch corresponds to this. So when you have a closed switch, you have a voltage across the terminals to be equal to 0. So I choose to replace the closed switch by two voltage sources which are equal and opposite, but I choose those voltage sources, the magnitude of each source, to be the same as the open circuit voltage that you have here. So the current here would be IL of S. This is what I of S, which is what we are after. This is the current which we are interested in. Now, I can use this principle of superposition and say this is equivalent to one in which you have VOC of S acting with all the internal sources, 1 by S, 1 by S, etc., plus another where the second voltage source is acting with a 1 ohm resistance S, and here the sources are deactivated. The internal sources are deactivated. That means when the switch is closed here, we are replacing the closed switch by two voltage sources. Each voltage source has been so chosen to be equal to the open circuit voltage here. So inside here, you have two sources, these two sources. Now I am to find out this current. What I am saying is, I use the principle of superposition. In the first place, I use the internal sources plus source A. And the second place, I deactivate all the other sources and keep only source B. Right. Now, you observe that this is exactly the situation here. When the switch is open, you have open circuit voltage VOC of S, all the other sources. Therefore, this current is 0. Now, the current here, that whatever current that comes here is what VOC, after all, we have deactivated all the sources here. So if the looking in impedance is Z0 of S here, the current that flows here will be VOC of S divided by Z0 of S plus 1. That is the current here. So original current was 0. The new current here is VOC of S or Z0 of S plus 1. And that must be the current here. Therefore, this current I of S can be obtained by solving this network alone. And how do we solve that network? You must find out VOC of S, find out the looking in impedance. And that's exactly what we did in the case of Thevenin's theorem. So we have interpreted the result that we have got here as an application of the substitution theorem instead of the Thevenin theorem. Ultimately, the work will be the same. You have to find out VOC of S, whatever means you have, and VOC of S can be interpreted as the open circuit voltage across the switch, which is of course 1 volt, therefore its Laplace transform is 1 by S. So if this is 1 by S, you have to find out the Thevenin impedance of that and calculate, that will be give you I of S. The incremental changes produced as a result of this source is this, but the original current was 0, so this plus this is the total current. So this is another way of looking at it. after having considered Thevenin's theorem, let us now see another theorem which is closely related to it, which goes by the name Norton's theorem. This is a kind of dual, the Thevenin's equivalent. You recall that in the case of Thevenin's theorem, when we said there is an active network containing linear elements and sources called NA, can be replaced, this two terminal network can be replaced by a voltage source VOCFS in series with a one port network having an impedance Z0FS. So for all practical purposes, this gives identical results as the original two terminal network insofar as its effect on an external conditions are concerned. We have an alternative equivalent circuit in which instead of the open circuit voltage here, we have a current source which is called the short circuit current source, ISCFS, in parallel with a one port network whose impedance continues to be the same as that before. So the output impedance of this network is now put in parallel and you have a current source. So this Norton equivalent is in the form of a current source in parallel with the output impedance, which is the same as the Thevenin impedance. It is called the short circuit current source because if this original network is short circuited to the terminals PQ, so if you have the original network NA and short circuit the terminals PQ, whatever current that flows through that is a short circuit current, and its Laplace transform, if you call that ISCFS, that is the short circuit current that you have to incorporate here. In other words, in the equivalent circuit, if you short circuit P and Q, the current that flows is ISCFS. This source strength must allow this current to flow through. So if you short the terminal sectionally, the current in the short circuit will be exactly the same as the source current. So this is an alternative way of doing this. Sometimes it may be easier for us to calculate the short circuit current, in which case we can use this equivalent. Sometimes it may be easier to calculate the open circuit voltage. It may be easier to adopt the Thevenin equivalent. But you observe that, after all, when you open circuit this, you get VOCFS. When you open circuit this network, we get ISC times Z0FS. And after all, these two are equivalent. Therefore, we have VOCFS equals the short circuit current times Z0FS. So in other words, of the three quantities that we have got, VOCFS, ISCFS, and Z0FS, only two are independent. Any two can be used to find out the third. So in certain problems, it might be easier for us to find out VOCFS and ISCFS. Then you don't have to calculate Z0FS. If you calculate these two, you can find out Z0FS and use either Thevenin's theorem or the Norton's equivalent. So it is not necessarily for us to calculate Z0FS every time. If it turns out that it's easier to calculate VOCFS and ISCFS, use that information to calculate Z0FS and use that either in this equivalent or in this equivalent. Okay. I will not discuss this further because the concept is straightforward, and some of you, I'm sure, will know. You have worked with Norton equivalent circuits in the DC domain or AC domain, so we will not pursue this further. I would also like to mention in this context an extension of these results which go by the name Millman's theorem. These are all straightforward extensions of these same similar concepts. Millman's theorem is applicable to a parallel connection of several sources, so VS1FS, Z1FS. Suppose you have a whole series of such branches, and I will say this is the kth branch, VSKFS and ZKFS. And like that, let us say there's the last branch is ZNFS and VSNFS. So if I have a whole series of such parallel branches, each branch containing a voltage source in series with an impedance, then the voltage between the two terminals between which all these parallel branches are connected is given by VABFS equals summed on K VSKFS times YKFS, where YKFS is the reciprocal of ZKFS, the driving point admittance of this one port network, divided by So this result is known as the Millman's theorem result. It can be obtained quite straightforward manner by application of Norton's equivalent. I will just outline the proof without going through that. Suppose you short circuit this, then the current that flows to the short circuit is Vs1 times Y1, Vs2 times Y2, Vsk times YKS, Vsn times Yn of S. That means this is a short circuit current. So that is the short circuit current. Now, the looking in impedance will be the parallel combination of all these, that is the looking in admittance is equal to this. So if you want to find out the open circuit voltage here, because after all nothing is connected, these two terminals are open circuited. So if you want to find out the open circuit voltage of this, is ISC of S times Z0 of S or ISC of S divided by Y0 of S. This will therefore be, this is the short circuit current ISC of S, this is Y0 of S, and that is how the result is. You can also use node analysis. All these will fetch the same result. Okay, so we will not discuss this further. Now we will move on to the next theorem, which is important, which is known as the compensation theorem. Now, before I discuss this, when you use the Thevenin's theorem or Norton's theorem, what you can do is, suppose you change this load impedance ZL, you can find out the new current here. That means whenever the impedance here is changed, if you want to find out new currents here, then a Thevenin or Norton equivalents are quite convenient because you set up a simpler equivalent and for different values of ZL, you can find out the new currents. But suppose I change this impedance here and want to find out its effect on the current somewhere here in the circuit. If I change this impedance, say, let us say, from 2 ohms to 3 ohms, what happens to the currents inside? Then neither Norton's equivalent nor Thevenin equivalents will give us a clue to this. Therefore, we should like to discuss this with a more powerful theorem which enables us to find out the effect of change in impedance on the rest of the circuit. And this is what is called the compensation theorem. Let me mention the statement of the theorem, then we'll discuss that further. To introduce the compensation theorem, let us consider this network. This box contains linear elements. It is acted upon by several voltage sources. I represented one of them, called Vsk. Several current sources, the kth current source is represented here carrying a current Isk. The current produced by the voltage source I call Isk. Just to distinguish between this and this, I use the lowercase letters here. Similarly, the voltage across the current source, I use small Vsk, just as distinguished from here. They're all functions of S. There are several elements inside carrying current voltage Vk and Ik. This is a typical element. And we have an impedance in the network, Z of S, carrying a current Is. The question which we would like to ask is, if this impedance changes by a certain amount, what are the consequent results, changes that are produced in the entire network? To do that, let us consider this altered network. In this altered network, we have the same voltage sources and current sources, same elements inside, but one particular impedance Zs is changed to Zs plus delta Zs. Consequently, all the values except the strengths of the independent sources will be altered. The current in this originally was Is, may be altered Is plus delta Is. The voltage here will be altered from Vk plus delta Vk, Ik, current Ik plus delta Ik. The current in the voltage source, originally Isk, may have been changed to Ik, Isk plus delta Isk. The voltage across the current source is from Vsk, it changes to delta Vsk. That means all the incremental quantities, all the changes are indicated by delta times the original values. So this is the altered network. In order to get the calculate all the variations or the alterations or the changes in this, the compensation theorem tells us you consider this network in which all the independent sources are deactivated. So the voltage sources are replaced by short circuits. The current sources are open circuited. These are internal elements. So the original current impedance Zs is carrying a current Is. So you have a voltage source whose strength is delta Zs, the change in the impedance times the original current. And you put the value of the new impedance that you are having here. So this voltage source in series with Zs plus delta Zs, acting in the original network with all the sources deactivated, whatever you are having, the solution of this network will give you exactly the increments or changes that are produced as a result of the change of impedance from ZS to delta ZS. In particular, the current associated with this is delta IK, the voltage associated with this is delta VK, the change in the voltage source current is delta ISK, this is delta VSK, and the current here is IS was changed to IS plus delta IS, so this is delta IS. That means to calculate the changes that are produced in the original network as a result of the change in impedance from ZS to delta, ZS plus delta ZS, you don't have to redo the calculation with all the sources present. You can do the calculation with only one source present, and that solution will give you the incremental value, the changes that are produced all over the network. That is the sum and substance of the compensation theorem. So the statement of the compensation theorem will be something like this. If in a linear network acted upon by independent sources, an impedance ZFS carrying a current IS is changed to ZS plus delta ZS, the incremental changes produced, that is inside the network, will be identical to those produced by a voltage source of strength delta ZS times IFS in series with the altered impedance in the network with all independent sources deactivated. And the direction or the polarity of the voltage source should act in a direction opposite to that of IS. The meaning of this is clear here. We are having a current IS here, and your voltage source is such as to drive a current opposite to IS. That's the, what is meant by acting in a direction opposite to that of IS. So this is the statement of the compensation theorem. Let me give a quick example to illustrate this. We'll prove this in the next lecture. To illustrate this theorem, let us consider a simple DC circuit, a 6-volt source acting in a circuit consisting of 3 2-ohm resistors. If you analyze the circuit, you will have 1 ampere here, 1 ampere here, because after all 2 in parallel with 2 is 1 ohm. So 3 ohms is the effective resistance, 2 amperes is the current here, 1 ampere current here, 1 ampere current is here. Now the question that we would like to ask is, if this 2 ohms is changed to 3 ohms, what is the resultant changes that are produced in the circuit? So the altered network here has got 6 volts again, the original source voltage, 2 ohms, 2 ohms, and this is changed from 2 ohms to 3 ohms. In order to find out the currents here, the changes that are brought about, we consider this incremental circuit in which we incorporate a source. After all, this 2 ohms is changed to 3 ohms. So delta R is equal to 1 ohm. The original current in the network is 1 ampere. So you have delta R times original current 1 volt. Change is 1 ohm. Current is 1 ampere. Therefore, this is a source of 1 volt, a DC source, acting in a circuit in which the original sources are deactivated. So this 6 volts is deactivated. It's replaced by a short circuit. So if you analyze the circuit, which consists of 3 ohms and 2 ohms in parallel, the currents will be 1/4 ampere, 1/8 ampere, and 1/8 ampere. So in this new circuit, you have, these are the changes, these are increments. So these are the changes that are brought about in the original circuit. Originally, it was 2 amperes here. Now there is an additional current of 1/8 ampere here. Therefore, the net current here is 2 minus 1/8 amperes. The current here is 1 ampere originally. The change that is brought about is 1/8. Therefore, the current here is 1 plus 1/8 of an ampere. The current here is originally 1 ampere. There is an opposite current of 1/4 of an ampere. Therefore, this current is 3/4 of an ampere. So this is how it is done. The advantage is, if you have several sources here and you want to carry out this analysis for the second time, it will be a little more complicated. But in this approach, you are dealing with only one source. Therefore, the changes that are brought about can be computed by analyzing this network with just one source. That is the advantage of the compensation theorem. We will prove in the next lecture the justify the statement of the compensation theorem and then work out further examples. So in this lecture, we have discussed the Thevenin's theorem in the framework of the transform diagrams, the Laplace transform approach. We worked out an example and showed its utility by establishing a simple equivalent circuit for a complicated linear network with several sources present. And we mentioned that this Thevenin's theorem approach is valid even if the network, replaced network, contains reciprocal or non-reciprocal elements, as long as the elements are linear, and the load network can be either linear or non-linear, the equivalent circuit is still valid. We also saw close relatives of the Thevenin's theorem, the Norton's theorem and the Millman's theorem, which can be derived quite in a straightforward fashion. And finally, we discussed the compensation theorem, which enables us to calculate the changes that are produced in an entire network consisting of linear elements and independent sources if one of the impedances is changed by a certain amount. And in the discussion of the compensation theorem, even though we said Z has changed from Z to Z plus delta Z, it does not mean that delta Z is going to be a very small quantity. It can be, the impedance can be doubled or tripled. Delta Z by no means should be a small quantity. We don't have to put that restriction. So all we say is if Z is changed from Z plus delta Z, the changes that are brought about in the entire network can be calculated by solving a simple network in which all the original independent sources are deactivated, but in this new network we have just one source whose strength is equal to a voltage source whose strength is equal to the change in the impedance delta Z multiplied by the current that was originally existing in Z in the original network, which is IFS. So delta Z times IFS acting in a network in series with the altered impedance Z plus delta Z, but in the network all the original voltage sources and current sources are deactivated. The solution of this will give you the altered quantities in the network. We will continue our discussion of the compensation theorem in the next lecture.